C4 and Bryan Nehman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
Tonight, based on the results of the renewal process and the recommendations of the Charter and Operator-Led Schools Advisory Board, I am recommending to the Baltimore City Board of School Commissioners that the contract with 5 Smooth Stones Incorporated, the school's operator for the Baltimore Collegiate School for Boys, be renewed for a 3-year period with conditions that the operator must take substantial steps to improve its management of the school. That is part of a very long statement by the Baltimore City Public Schools CEO, Bryan Nehman, audience, Dr. Sonja Santelesis, basically saying she is okay with the Baltimore Collegiate School for Boys being renewed for her for the charter. And this was in front of the school board last night. And what do you get a take, Bryan, for one of the school board members? Joining us right now is Ashley Esposito. She is one of the 2 elected school board. We had our first election, Bryan. You've got them in Arundel County, but first elected school board members in November. She was just sworn in. And it's a pleasure to speak with you, Commissioner Esposito.
Great to have you on.
Hi, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much. Look, you texted us in the midst of our discussion about this the other day as we were looking into what was going to happen for the Baltimore School, Baltimore Collegiate School for Boys. And we appreciate you joining. You have a newsletter you also put out trying to inform the community of what your thoughts are as a school commissioner. What were your thoughts last night as you were listening to this?
I think it was a very robust conversation. Like, there's a lot of issues that other commissioners had brought up that I'm sure will be addressed on Thursday. And so I was happy with that outcome because it did reflect what the community had said in their meeting on Tuesday at the school. So, yeah, I think it did what it was supposed to do, having that meeting. And for me, like, I've been, you know, just the nature of a campaign, we have to reach out to so many people and listen to their concerns. And the fact that, you know, there were new people that I met there who were like, is it worth it? Like, is this a done deal? Like, this proves that community input is valuable.
Okay, that's good to know. Were you surprised from the recommendation from Sonja Santelesis last night to extend the contract or renew their charter?
No, because I knew that it would, like, everything would be flushed out, like, on at the February 14th meeting, because I knew there was other schools that I didn't 100% know what the recommendation was. So there had just been basically I found out about the meeting on Tuesday through Councilwoman Ramos's newsletter. And so that was like a call for everybody to like say their piece. And so to see that it had changed and wasn't really like finalized until we actually sat in that meeting, I think is a good thing.
We have school board member, brand new commissioner of the Baltimore City School Board, Ashley Esposito, on board with us. And Commissioner Esposito, one of the concerns I've had and others, and this is just going back to the time before we actually had charter schools. My son went to Midtown Academy, which was at that time, they called it a transitional school or something before we actually had charters. Is there a negative attitude towards charter schools? That's kind of what people are concerned about. Like, for whatever reason, charters are kind of looked down on from the school board level.
I don't think so. I haven't seen that. So, like for example, like during the campaign, we were asked a lot about our opinions about charter schools. And even, you know, the charter schools are involved in the appointment process of school board members and are able to ask those questions. So I don't see them necessarily being in conflict, because it is a different situation than some charter school programs in other areas. So I do see the charter schools working more in collaboration with not just the school system, but also other schools. And I was able to go to the charter school fair and have been visiting, you know, traditional and public charter schools. So I don't really see it being in conflict necessarily.
But you did say that you thought that the city was closing too many schools and too often.
Well, yeah. So
why is that? Why do you think that has been, you know, taking place for so many years?
Honestly, I think that, like, I mean, we already know that the city, like, historically was disinvested. We're losing population. My question is, as a community member, are we losing population because some areas are less desirable because they've become school deserts? Or, you know, are some neighborhoods, you know, like, basically in my own community, like, I've received emails from people who you know, said, oh, I love your neighborhood. I love the people that I met there. I would love to buy there. But when I went to look at schools, I chose to move to the Northeast or Northwest. Like, they were on the fence about buying in our area. And that was, like, the feedback that we got. And so I'm like, you know, as I see them closing schools, and one of the justifications is, oh, the enrollment's down. I look at the surrounding community and the census and see that is the declining population because they're moving to areas where there is easier access for the school. Because other feedback from the community is not everybody's 100% comfortable with putting their kids on public transportation to go to areas of their of a school that they would like to go to. So, yeah, it's really complicated. And I have seen community members feel like they haven't, like, had all the information up front or being notified in advance far enough to be able to, like, voice their concerns. So they kind of felt like closures were happening to them and not in collaboration with them. And I think, you know, from what I'm seeing on the inside and previous conversations, I think there is more that needs to be shared about the 21st century schools and that plan, because I think it would explain a lot of the motivations or even considerations of closing schools at all. But also, like, working with the General Assembly, I think there are ways for us to secure funds to remove some of the reasons why some schools are closed. Like, for example, building and infrastructure. We have some of the oldest school buildings in this city. And I don't think that, I think if there wasn't funding for maintenance and things are the way that they are, let's look at creative ways to get more funding so that we can improve that, so we don't have to close schools. Because, I mean, school closures are, like, traumatic.
Devastating.
For, like,
devastating. Yeah. Ashley Esposito is on board with us, Baltimore City School Commissioner, just elected, one of two of the 12 school board members that are elected in the city of Baltimore. And you mentioned it, you know, for a couple of times when I was in legislature, we fought the closure of Utah Marshburn. You mentioned that in your newsletter, the fact that that school is being closed. And it was very subjective, not objective, some of the reasons in the past when they tried to close Utah Marshburn, which was in my legislative district. But when it comes to the Baltimore Collegiate School for Boys, Commissioner Esposito, what have you seen, or what do you think about the way that they're running the school? I know you still have to vote on this next week, so I'm not necessarily, you know, asking you how you're going to vote. But from all outside appearance, I mean, the governor of the state of Maryland invites them down on Inauguration Day, takes pictures with them. They have all types of people from around the state that come to visit their school that talk about how these young boys are comporting themselves. It's just like every exterior look at this appears that they're running this school effectively.
Yeah, well, even the community members there and, you know, like, staff folks, like, the open discussion that we had at the school, they did bring up some of the previous issues. And so, like, what I see is that time kind of, like, wasn't on their side. So, like, for example, like, having the newer principal and then being hit with the pandemic. So, of course, there's going to be, like, it's like, kind of like a double whammy. You know, you're trying to adjust to new leadership and also, you know, you don't already have established relationships, but you're doing the best you can and trying to, like, help the entire community through the pandemic. And so I think as a result, like, this is the right decision because they're given that more time because somebody had stood up at the meeting and said that, you know, in order for a principal to be effective, like, they need time, like, somewhere around, like, 5 to 10 years to really see, like, the impact of having that new leadership. And I think with the renewal and the timeline that they've already had in the past, like, that is accurate to that point that somebody made.
But do you think this school, the Baltimore Collegiate School, is doing a better job than the average Baltimore City school?
I mean, it depends on what you're looking at. Like, I don't think... Yeah, I don't know. Like,
well, my point is that you have so many kids that obviously are struggling, right? We've got these statistics that are just mind-numbing about, you know, what kids are not really achieving.
Like,
you know,
zero kids passing
0% in some of these
efficiency
schools. In some schools, it's one or two, and you've got a high school. And I know it's mainly a Spanish language kind of second language issue at Patterson, where they're not even reading on a high school level. And this is a school that we have heard is doing pretty well with kids, and they're going on, and they're going to high school, they're graduating.
90% of their eighth graders that came out as they come in high school are graduating. 50% of them are going to college. And they've quantified that with their numbers.
I guess when I compare those stories to what I heard about this school, I ask, well, why is this thing even in jeopardy of losing its license because of that?
Yeah, well, what I see, and especially throughout the campaign, meeting people from different areas, there are a bunch of traditional schools that are doing amazing work. And what some of the feedback that I got from the students is that, it's more, I don't know how to phrase it. I think we get more coverage about what we're doing wrong than what we're doing right. And so, there's tons of students, especially in the Baltimore Student Union or the ASCBC, who have students that have thrived in the traditional environment. And so I don't think that, and also I see other jurisdictions are also struggling in the same area. So I think that should be pointed out.
Sure.
Yeah. So I think, I don't know, I don't like comparing schools, just saying oh, this one's better. Cause there's so many, they offer different programming, they serve different populations. So it's a lot more nuanced than
but
that.
But we should, Commissioner Esposito, focus on best practices. And one of the things right. that I have said, and I don't know, as a new school board member, you can actually get this. There's an organization out of Stanford University called Credo, C-R-E-D-O. They go around the country and look at how charter schools perform as opposed to traditional public schools. And each year, their studies show in Maryland, I'm not going anywhere else, they do every state, in Maryland, their charter schools academically are just performing better than traditional public schools. Not 100%, but overwhelmingly, they are. And one of the main reasons is parental involvement. They talk about the requirement of parental involvement that traditional schools don't have, that charters has, goes a long way to that, Commissioner Esposito.
Yeah, and my question would be, are they vetting whether or not there's parent involvement in advance? Or is that something that is cultivated by the community, within that school specifically? Because I do see that existing in other spaces. So the charter process is still a bit complicated to me. So I know that.
But where we can numerically quantify something, the denial, I'm not talking about you, you just joined, the denial of this school board and this superintendent to numbers, to straight up numbers, forget emotion, is stunning to most people out here that numbers just fly out there and you go, well, that number isn't, it is real. It's the number. The number is what the number is.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying. I'm not putting it on you. I'm not putting this. Oh. I'm just telling you when it comes to the public, general public hearing certain things in Baltimore City Public Schools, the numbers are somehow dismissed for all these other types of non-quantifiable issues that look like politics, just like looks like politics
well,
to most
let
people.
Me ask you.
That hasn't been the experience that, because even my school, even my community school back in the day, Not anytime recent, but when their numbers were down, they were notified, they were given an opportunity to correct it. They were, even enrollment numbers, so at a school level, I do see them acting on based on the data that you're talking about. So, because the goal is I see them acting with a sense of urgency.
That's what I want.
And
that's what I want.
And that's, yeah. But I think that it's hard to, it's hard to show that publicly when the staff are running around doing these things, or if the community is throwing in extra support. We don't have our own communications to be hey guys, we are doing this thing. I think as a community member, I do see a lot of support coming in.
How would you describe the Baltimore City school system right now? How is it performing?
I think I see two things. So definitely the blueprint is really important. So, because that is addressing some of the historic disinvestment, the 21st century schools, I have visited some, and I do think that's an opportunity to catch up where other jurisdictions are. Because like I said before, our infrastructure is crazy old. And I do think that we'll look back at this time in the future and see improvement and see a turning point. But first of all, the blueprint needs to be fully funded. And also, I think that just having elected members it adds value to the board.
Totally.
Because I think before, just having members that are appointed, there is a bit of a disconnect between them and the community. No, it's no shade to them at all. I just think that
I'll throw shade. You don't have to. I'll do it. They need to be more elected.
They're awesome.
There need to be more elected board members between you and Kwame Kenyatta Bay, who's your other elected school board member. We got to end it here. But Commissioner Esposito, we would like to talk with you maybe after the 23rd when the vote of the school board is taken. And hopefully this Baltimore Collegiate School for Boys is not that their charter is renewed. But we do appreciate your time.
Yeah, thanks for coming on.
Yeah, thank you.
I appreciate it. That is the new elected school board member, Ashley Esposito. And she sounds very idealistic. She just joined this thing. Her first meeting was yesterday, Brian. Mm-hmm. So she's brand new to all of this. But I just go back to the thing, Brian, where I look at how this board operates with charters and how they operate with traditional schools. And you can see the difference. You can just see how they have antipathy to them, regardless of how they're nice sounding and everything is. They just don't like charters.
Well, I just would like to see the audits that they could do on the public schools that they're doing on these charter schools.
Thank
and
you.
See what kind of problems we would have.
How many letters did that school get? How many expulsions or suspensions did that school have?
Exactly.